And as we start this session on all the paths, we have done already three sessions on the partition suits. And today we are discussing upon the final decree in the partition suits. And the speaker for today is Mr. S. R. Somashekhar, a former district judge, principal district judge from Bengaluru. And his all previous sessions, not only on the partitions, but the other sessions have also done extremely well. That only shows us that the way he teaches us, the way he takes things forward, are always well received amongst the participants who are watching us live, not only on this platform, but also on YouTube and Facebook. Before we will request Mr. Somashekhar, we will again request that continue to maintain social distancing, keep on wearing your mask, as well as do your vaccination, and do not go out of the home until unless it's very essential. And as we all know that we have shared the topic, and the today's topic is final decree proceedings in partition suits. And over to you, sir. It's a pleasure connecting with you.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Vikas Chetrath, and good evening, friends. The topic for discussion this evening is final decree proceedings in partition suits. Please focus on the title. You are able to hear me? Yes. Please focus on the title. Final decree proceedings in partition suits. It contemplates three things. There is already a preliminary decree. Therefore, a proceeding is now initiated for drawing a final decree. That there is a different kind of a proceeding as far as a partition suit is concerned when it comes to final decree. Those of you who have put in at least 1 year of practice would have by now known that there is practically no difference in the trial procedure in respect of different kinds of suits, except with a slight modification regarding Section 6 of the specific suit under Section 6 of the Specific Relief Act, or summary suits under Article 37. In respect of all other suits, be it a suit for recovery of money, specific performance, declaration, injunction, or whatever it is, there is absolutely no difference in the procedure when it comes to the suit, trial of a suit. But in the case of final decree, there are different procedures. Before I tell you what actually the procedure in a final decree proceeding in a partition suit, I would, for the benefit of the younger members of the bar, read for myself and request them also to go through the explanation to Section 2, Subsection 2 of the Code of Civil Procedure. Section 2, Subsection 2 defines what a decree is. Kindly go to the explanation. A decree is preliminary when further proceedings have to be taken before the suit can be completely disposed of. If it is final when such adjudication completely disposes of the suit, it may be partly preliminary and partly final. Therefore, a decree could be preliminary, then a final. It could be partly preliminary and partly final. During the course of the presentation, you will yourself realize as to when a decree could be partly preliminary and partly final. Let me not waste time right now on that. Now, when the statute itself says that a decree could be preliminary, obviously it means at least in certain suits, a preliminary decree is passed followed by a final decree. Though I am conscious of the fact that we are discussing about final decree proceedings in partition suits, for the benefit of the young advocates, I would just like to tell them, in what other kinds of suits a preliminary decree is passed followed by a final decree. Please go to Order 20 CPC. Order 20 has this as its title, Judgment and Decree. go to order 20, rule 12. Decree for possession and mean profits. Where a suit is for the recovery of possession of immovable property and for rent or mean profits, the court may pass a decree for the possession of the property. B, for rents which have accrued on the property during the period prior to the institution of the suit. BA, for the mean profits, directing an inquiry as to such mean profits, directing an inquiry as to rent or mean profits from the institution of the suit until the delivery of possession. Therefore, though the word preliminary decree is not used or final decree is not used, Order 20, Rule 12 contemplates a decree where you pass a preliminary decree and give a direction to the defendant to deliver possession. If it is a question of future mean profits, then it is during final decree proceedings what exactly is the future mean profits to which the plaintiff is entitled would be determined. Then go to Order 20, Rule 13. Where a suit is for an account of any property and for its due administration under the decree of the court shall, before passing the final decree, pass a preliminary decree ordering such accounts. So, in administration suits also, two decrees are contemplated. Then, go to Order 20, Rule 15. Decree in a suit for dissolution of partnership. Where a suit is for the dissolution of partnership or the taking of partnership accounts, the court, before passing a final decree, may pass a preliminary decree. Then, Order 20, Rule 16. In a suit for an account of pecuniary transactions between a principal and an agent, and in any other suit not herein before provided for, where it is necessary in order to ascertain the amount of money due or from any party, that an account should be taken, the court shall, before passing its final decree, pass a preliminary decree. Then, Order 20, Rule 18. This is a decree in a partition suit. This is what we are discussing today. Please carefully read it. Where the court passes a decree for the partition of property or for the separate possession of a share therein, if and in so far as the decree relates to an estate assessed to the payment of revenue to the government, the decree shall declare the rights of the several parties interested in the property, but shall direct such partition or separation to be made by the collector or any gazetted subordinate of the collector deputed by him in this behalf in accordance with such declaration and with the provisions of Section 54. Karnataka has brought an amendment to Order 20, Rule 18, Subrule 1. I am not aware whether other states in the country have brought about a similar amendment. Experience was when proceedings were rather, when a warrant was sent to the deputy commissioner, we call the collector in Karnataka as deputy commissioner, for effecting a partition of lands assessed to land revenue. The proceedings took a good lot of time and nothing could have been done. Therefore, the legislature thought that there should be an amendment to Order 20, Rule 18. And those of you who have the benefit of having the Karnataka amendment will kindly go to Order 20, Rule 18 as amended by the Karnataka State Legislature. Rather, it's Karnataka High Court amendment. Order 20, Rule 18, Subrule 1 as amended by the Karnataka High Court reads thus. If and in so far as the decree relates to an estate assessed to land revenue to the government, the decree shall declare the rights of the several parties interested in the property, and such partition or separation shall be made by the court in accordance with such declaration and Section 54. Central Act says it shall be made by the collector, here we call the deputy commissioner, but the Karnataka amendment is the court itself shall make such a division. A similar amendment is brought to Section 54 CPC. First, we shall read the central enactment as it is. go to section 54 CPC. Partition of estate or separation of shares. Where the decree is for the partition of an undivided estate assessed to the payment of revenue to the government or for the separate possession of a share of such an estate, the partition of the estate or the separation of the share shall be made by the collector or any gazetted subordinate of the collector deputed by him in this behalf in accordance with the law, if any, for the time being in force relating to the partition or the separate possession of shares of such estates. Almost similar to Order 20, Rule 18.1. Let us see the Karnataka Amendment to Section 54 CPC. I am reading Karnataka Amendment to Section 54. Where the decree is for the partition of an undivided estate, assessed to the payment of revenue to the government, or for the separate possession of a share of such an estate, the partition of the estate or the separation of the share of such an estate shall be made by the court in accordance with the law, shall be made by the court in accordance with the law. Therefore, both Section 54 and Order 20, Rule 18, Subrule 1 contemplate a division by the court itself. But Section 54 further provides the Karnataka Amendment, and if necessary, on the report of a revenue officer, not below the rank of a tahsildar, or such other person as the court may appoint as commissioner in that behalf. Therefore, normally the court would appoint some revenue officer not below the rank of a tahsildar or any other person. Usually, a surveyor is appointed not to effect a division but to give a report to the court to see as to how well the court can actually divide the properties, just as in the case of other immovable properties or urban properties. This is the position. I will read Order 20, Rule 18 again. As an amended, 20 Rule 18 Subrule 1 contemplates a decree in respect of lands assessed to land revenue. You will find that the word preliminary is not used anywhere in Subrule 1 of R20 Rule 18. If and in so far as the decree relates to an estate assessed to the payment of etc., the decree shall declare the rights of the several parties interested in the property, but shall direct such partition or separation to be made by the collector. Why it is so? Before Section 54 and Order 20, Rule 18, Subrule 1 came to be amended by Karnataka or elsewhere also there will be a similar amendment, the legal position was, and probably it continues to be so in other states where there is no such amendment, the civil court passes a decree declaring the shares of the several parties. Thereafter, the decree is sent to the collector or the deputy commissioner for effecting a division by meets and bounds. The civil court thereafter becomes functus officio. Now let us see 20 Rule 18 Subrule 2. If and in so far as such decree relates to any other movable property or movable property, the court may, if the partition or separation cannot be conveniently made without further inquiry, pass a preliminary decree declaring the rights of the several parties interested in the property and giving such further directions as may be required. I am not going into details of division of a movable property. Let us any other immovable property, a site or a house property, here what we do is a preliminary decree is passed declaring the rights of several parties. When, if without further inquiry, actually the court cannot come to a conclusion whether the property can be conveniently divided or not. Well, advocates who have put in some practice, at least for 5 years or 4 years, would have by now known. During the course of trial, focus is only on establishing the relationship between the parties, if that is denied by the defendants, nature of the properties, whether it is joint family property, ancestral property, self-acquisition, separation, all that, and what is the share to which the plaintiff and the defendants are entitled. Not much of a focus is given about the convenience or otherwise, or the feasibility or otherwise, or the property to be divided by meets and bounds. Normally, focus is not there. Therefore, without further inquiry, the court cannot come to a conclusion whether it could be divided by meets and bounds, and therefore that inquiry is done during the course of final decree proceedings. This is the situation. Now, I said the court becomes functus officio. Here again, I am not sure about the provisions in the local land revenue laws. In Karnataka, we have the Karnataka Land Revenue Act of 1964. Section 49 of the Karnataka Land Revenue Act provides for appeals from original owners. Save as otherwise expressly provided, an appeal shall lie from every original order passed under this act or the rules made thereunder, and from every order made in exercise of the powers conferred by Section 54 of the Code of Civil Procedure. That means, when a preliminary decree was sent to the collector, then if some order was passed by the revenue authority in a proceeding under Section 54 CPC, well, an appeal was provided under the Act itself to the various authorities thereunder. This is the situation. Therefore, the view that was taken by the Karnataka High Court long back was, when once the preliminary decree was sent to the Deputy Commissioner for effecting a division of land assessed to land revenue, the civil court became functus officio. If any order was passed by the revenue authority during those proceedings, an appeal could be preferred under the provisions of the Land Revenue Act. So nothing more was required to be done. It was only in respect of the other kinds of immovable properties, house properties, buildings, sites, etc., the civil court was required to do this. Now, of course, in the amendment to Section 54 CPC, even in respect of lands assessed to the land revenue, the civil court is expected to make a division. This is the now. Please go to Section 74. I'm sorry, 75. Power of the court to issue commission, subject to such conditions and limitations as may be prescribed, the court may issue a commission for various purposes. D, to make a partition. The court may issue a commission to make a partition. Subject to conditions and limitations as to be prescribed. The word prescribed is also defined in Section 2. Prescribed means prescribed by the rules. Rules is also defined. Where do we get it? 218. Rules means rules and forms contained in the first schedule are made under Section 122 or 125. First schedule contains the order portion of the Civil Procedure Code. Therefore, in accordance with the rules contained in the order portion of the Civil Procedure Code, the corresponding order as far as Section 75 is concerned, as many of you may be knowing, is Order 26. Let us go to Order 26. There you find different subheads: commission to examine witnesses, commission for local investigation, commission for scientific investigation, commission to examine accounts. Thereafter you have this commission to make partitions. There you have two rules, Rule 13 and Rule 14. I will read Rule 13. Where a preliminary decree for partition has been passed, the court may, in any case not provided for by Section 54, issue a commission to such person as it thinks fit to make the partition or separation according to the rights as declared in such decree. So this is a further indication that in respect of lands assessed to land revenue, the question of the court affecting a division is not permissible, except as I said, because section 54 CPC is now amended, or 20 rule 18 sub rule 1 is also amended. In Karnataka, it is possible for the court to effect a division even in respect of lands assessed to land revenue. Now, there is an amendment to Order 26, Rule 40 by the Karnataka High Court. Order 26, Rule 40, the Central Act shows that there are three sub-rules there. Sub-rule 4, Karnataka High Court Amendment, where the court passes a final decree according to the foregoing provisions, then in the case of estate assessed to land revenue payable to government, intimation shall be given to the Deputy Commissioner of the district, who shall cause appropriate entries to be made in the revenue and survey records. So now, let us read 20 Rule 14. So 20 Rule 26 Rule 13 applies to lands assessed to land revenue. 26 Rule 14 other property. The commissioner shall, after such inquiry as may be coming, 26 Rule 13 also doesn't refer to agricultural lands because it says except as provided by Section 54. So therefore, the procedure contemplated by Rule 14 is in respect of urban property, that is sites, buildings. The commissioner shall, after such inquiry as may be necessary, divide the property into as many shares as may be directed by the order under which the commission was issued, and shall allot such shares to the parties, and may, if authorized thereto by the said order, award sums to be paid for the purpose of equalizing the value of the shares. The commissioner shall then prepare and sign a report, or the commissioners, where the commission was issued to more than one person and they cannot agree, shall prepare and sign separately reports appointing the share of each party and distinguishing each share, if so directed by the said order, by beats and bounds. Such report or report shall be annexed to the commission and transmitted to the court, and the court, after hearing any objections which the parties may make to the report or reports, shall confirm, vary, or set aside the same. Where the court confirms or varies the report or reports, it shall pass a decree in accordance with the same as confirmed or varied. But where the court sets aside the report or reports, it shall either issue a new commission or make such other order as it shall think fit. Here again, though the word final decree is not used, it means where the court confirms or varies the report or reports, it shall pass a decree, means it shall pass a final decree. Now, I have already read Section 54 CPC. Where do you find Section 54 of the Civil Procedure Code? You will find it in Part 2 of the Civil Procedure Code with the title Execution. It starts from Section 36 and ends with Section 74. Section 54 is placed there. This is likely to mislead many of us. Whether a proceeding under Section 54 CPC for division of lands assessed to land revenue is a proceeding in execution. I am not aware of any decision of the Supreme Court. Obviously, I am not aware of decisions of other high courts. As far as the Karnataka High Court is concerned, we have two decisions. Many may be knowing that the state of Karnataka was earlier called the state of Mysore, and obviously the High Court of Karnataka was also called the High Court of Mysore. We have two decisions, AER 1959 Mysore 233, AER 1959 Mysore 233, and AER 1965 Mysore 73. Of course, in the decision 65, 59 has been followed. 59 is of a division bench. Honorable Justice K.S. Hegde, who later became a judge of the Supreme Court, wrote the judgment on behalf of the division bench in the case reported in AR 1959, Mysore. His Lordship said, perhaps the section 54 could not have placed anywhere else, and therefore the legislature thought it fit to include it in the provisions where the execution proceedings are included. Merely because section 54 finds a place there, it cannot be said to be an execution proceeding. The matter reached the High Court of Mysore in a different situation. What happened was, in fact, long after the preliminary decree was passed, nearly 35 or 40 years after the preliminary decree was passed, final decree proceedings were initiated. It was contended on behalf of the defendant respondents that initiation of final decree proceedings 35 to 40 years after the preliminary decree was passed was barred by time. The argument canvassed was section 54 CPC is included in that part of CPC which deals with execution, and therefore it is a proceeding in the nature of an execution, as the limitation had then stood, the limitation for initiating an execution proceeding was 3 years, and therefore the final decree proceedings were barred by time. The division bench did not accept the contention, and as I said, it observed, merely because section 54 finds a place in the group of sections relating to execution, it is not a proceeding in execution. Probably it could not have been placed anywhere else, and therefore it has been put there. Further, it was held by the division bench, there is nothing like an application being filed for initiation of final decree proceedings. This is the legal position throughout. It doesn't contemplate an application on the part of the plaintiff or even the defendant, if he has also been given a share. No application is contemplated for initiating final decree proceedings. When no application is contemplated, there is no question of limitation at all. If at all an application is filed, courts have said, it is only a reminder to the court to do its duty. The court cannot rest content with passing a preliminary decree. It is its duty to see that a final decree is also passed in terms of the preliminary decree. Therefore, it cannot expect any application on the part of the plaintiff. It has to do its duty. If at all such an application is filed, it is only a reminder to the court to do its duty. This is the consistent view taken by the Karnataka High Court. And I have a judgment of the Supreme Court also written by Justice R.V. Ravindran. And I think right now it is better I refer to that judgment so that our further discussion would go correctly. Please make a note of the judgment of the Supreme Court in this regard. Straight away we will deal with that instead of going here and there. The judgment of the Supreme Court referred to by me is reported in 2009, Volume 9, SCC 689. 2009, Volume 9, SCC 689. In fact, His Lordship has said in a situation should come where there should be no need to number an execution proceeding separately or a final decree proceeding and all that. Legislature should step in. Several directions have been given. And ultimately it has been said, there is nothing like an application being filed. It is the duty of the court to do it. His Lordship has also said that when a partition suit is disposed of by way of a preliminary decree, the court, without waiting for the plaintiff to make an application for final decree, should itself give a fixed date for taking steps for drawing the final decree. This is what His Lordship has said. Thus, the application for final decree as and when made is considered to be an application, a pending suit for granting the relief of division by meets and bounds. So this is the view taken, and it's a fairly long judgment and very enlightening judgment, and I request all the participants to go through that judgment at your leisure. Again, go back to the definition, rather explanation given to section 2, subsection 2. A decree is preliminary when further proceedings have to be taken before the suit can be completely disposed of. It is final when such adjudication completely disposes of the suit. It may be partly preliminary and partly final. Now, this distinction between preliminary decree and final decree has been explained by the Supreme Court in 2003, volume 10, SCC 200. 2003, volume 10, SCC 200. Distinction between preliminary decree and final decree. This is Renu Devi versus Mahendra Singh. Of course, in para 8 of the judgment at page 206, you will get this explanation regarding the difference between a preliminary decree and a final decree. Some passage from Mullah's CPC has also been referred to. Please go through it. You will get to know the concept of a preliminary decree and a final decree and the difference between the two. As I said, by referring to the division bench decision of the Karnataka High Court in AR 1959, Mysore 233, there is no question of the plaintiff filing an application for a final decree in a partition. In a final decree in a partition suit, please don't think that for other the final decrees also no application is contemplated. I forgot to mention that even in a mortgage suit, a preliminary decree followed by a final decree is contemplated. That is covered by Order 34 CPC. There we have that limitation. But as far as final decree in a partition suit is concerned, no application is contemplated and therefore no question of limitation arises. We have a subsequent judgment of the Supreme Court, 2007, volume 2, SCC 355. 2007, volume 2, SCC 355. At para 9 of this judgment, it is said that there is no period of limitation for initiation of final decree proceedings. In the same decision at para 7, it is said that in a given case, a decree can be both preliminary and final. This requires some explanation. A decree can be both preliminary and final in a given case. Let us again read Order 20, Rule 18. Where the court passes a decree for the partition of property or for the separate possession of a share therein, if and in so far as the decree relates to an estate assessed to the payment of revenue to the government, the decree shall declare the rights of the several parties interested in the property, but shall direct such partition or separation to be made by the collector. 20 Rule 18 Subrule 2 says, if and in so far as such a decree relates to any other immovable property or movable property, the court may, if the partition or separation cannot be conveniently made without further inquiry, pass a preliminary decree. Supposing there is material before the court to say that the property is capable of being divided by meets and bounds, and no further inquiry is called for, in respect of those house properties, certainly a final decree can be passed. In respect of agricultural lands assessed to land revenue, a preliminary decree can be passed. So therefore, a decree can be partly preliminary and partly final. This is, we find this statement in 2007, volume 2, SCC 355. The next concept which you should know is that there can be more than one preliminary decree. What does it mean? There can be more than one preliminary decree. AER 1967 Supreme Court 1470. AER 1967 Supreme Court 1470. This is a very famous decision. Phool Chand versus Phool Chand versus Gopal Law. It is followed in many judgments. There can be more than one preliminary decree. What does that mean? Please give me full attention to what I am telling. plaintiff is declared to have 1/4 share. In the preliminary decree, a decree is passed saying that the plaintiff is entitled to 1/4 share. Let us say his mother was also a party to the suit and she was one of the defendants. A suit was filed by the plaintiff against his mother, brother, sisters and all that, let us say. He was held entitled to 1/4 share in the suit schedule properties. Preliminary decree was passed. Subsequent to the death of the, subsequent to the passing of the preliminary decree, the mother dies. As a consequence of the death of the mother, the share of the plaintiff as well as the share of the remaining defendants gets enhanced. Therefore, the court dealing with this final decree proceeding can take note of the subsequent event and accordingly modify the preliminary decree and say that instead of 1/4, the parties are now entitled to 1/3 share. It is perfectly permissible. There is no need to file a separate suit. The subsequent development can be taken note of during final decree proceedings, and accordingly, the preliminary decree can be modified. Here, there are certain procedures here. Well, there can be a formal amendment to the preliminary decree, making the note of the submissions made by both the counsel in the order sheet of the final decree proceedings. Well, it is admitted that subsequent to the passing of the preliminary decree, one of the parties to the suit died. He or she was related to the remaining parties to the suit in a particular manner. As a consequence of his or her death, the share of the remaining parties gets enhanced to this extent. And therefore, the preliminary decree passed on such and such a day stands modified and it shall now read like this. A note in the order sheet should be sufficient, or a formal amendment to the preliminary decree also can be made. It's only a question of procedure. You need not worry so much about it. But the fact remains that there can be more than one preliminary decree. In the decision in 2007-2 SEC 355, which I refer to in two different contexts on the point of limitation, there is no limitation. It can be both preliminary and final. There is an observation that there can be more than one final decree. Though many of us are already familiar with this position in law, that there can be more than one preliminary decree, can there be more than one final decree? I am reading para 8 of the judgment in 2007-2 SEC 355. There can be more than one final decree. A decree may be partly preliminary and partly final. What is this? There can be more than one final decree. How does it happen? Again, go to Order 20, Rule 80. Well, there are agricultural lands, assessed to land revenue. There are urban properties. Right? A preliminary decree is passed. Now, during the course of final decree proceedings, let us say a commissioner is appointed for division of the house property. Then a commissioner is appointed to assist the court for the division of agricultural lands, assistance of the court as far as Karnataka is concerned. Elsewhere, the warrant itself is sent to the deputy commissioner for effecting the division, if there is no amendment to Section 54 CPC. Now, for the deputy commissioner to give a report in respect of those agricultural lands, it may take quite some time. Therefore, the parties may say, the commissioner, who is generally an engineer in respect of this house property, who is appointed, has already given his report. The court may peruse his report and pass a final decree as far as the house property is concerned, and the proceedings may be kept pending in respect of the agricultural lands for which a separate report is required. Therefore, in such a situation, there can be two final decrees also. Please understand this. It is in that sense, probably, the observation is made. So, a decree can be partly preliminary, It can be partly final. There can be more than one preliminary decree. There can be more than one final decree. I told you that subsequent to the passing of the preliminary decree, if there is the death of any of the parties to the suit, the court can take note of it and suitably modify the preliminary decree and hence the share. Absolutely no difficulty about it. But when once a preliminary decree is passed and there is no change in the circumstance like death or anything, the court dealing with these final decree proceedings cannot go behind the preliminary decree. Cannot go behind the preliminary decree. I will tell like this. Now, the trial, the parties took a stand. Plaintiff said that the properties are all joint family properties. Defendant said that certain properties are self-acquired and certain properties are joint family properties. The court did not accept their contention. It held that all the properties to be joint family properties. The defendants cannot say during final decree proceedings, we have now come across certain documents which definitely go to show that items so and so are our self-acquisitions and therefore please examine this and modify it. No. The court dealing with the final decree proceeding cannot go behind the preliminary decree. Taking note of certain subsequent events like that, certainly the preliminary decree can be modified, but if it requires a re-examination of the facts, re-examination of the contention search, the court dealing with final decree proceeding cannot do it. It cannot go behind the preliminary decree. Supposing the court has already come to a conclusion that the plaintiff, let us say the first plaintiff, a widow, he is the widow of so and so. Well, in final decree proceedings, the defendants cannot say, we have no sufficient evidence to say that the first plaintiff was not married to that ex at all. She was married to someone else. You want to demonstrate it? No. This is certainly going behind the preliminary decree. We have one principle in execution that an executing court cannot go behind the preliminary decree. Similarly, a court dealing with final decree proceedings cannot go behind the preliminary decree. Here, please go to section. Of course, with regard to the position that the final decree proceedings, the court dealing with a final decree proceeding cannot go behind the preliminary decree, it is well settled. We have a judgment of the Karnataka High Court in ILR 2007, Karnataka 4308. ILR 2007, Karnataka 4308, para 17. Please go to section 97 CPC. Appeal from final decree, where no appeal from preliminary decree. Where any party aggrieved by a preliminary decree passed after the commencement of this court does not appeal from such decree, he shall be precluded from disputing its correctness in any appeal which may be preferred from the final decree. Now, a preliminary decree is passed declaring that the plaintiff is entitled to a particular share. Let us say the plaintiff had sought 1/3 share. Court gives him only 1/4 share. He does not challenge that preliminary decree by filing a regular appeal under section 96 CPC. Or the defendants do not challenge it. Therefore, the preliminary decree remains. Now, final decree proceedings are initiated. A final decree is passed. Again, a regular appeal slides against that final decree. When a regular appeal is filed against the final decree, neither this plaintiff nor the defendant can contend in the appellate court that the preliminary decree is incorrect. So if a person is aggrieved by the preliminary decree, he has to challenge that preliminary decree by way of an appeal under section 96 CPC. When an appeal is preferred against the final decree, the correctness of the finding given in the preliminary decree cannot be agitated, is what section 97 CPC says. So, because my advice to the young lawyers is this. Well, I have said that the court dealing with final decree proceedings can take note of subsequent events, modify the preliminary decree. Therefore, If your client is really aggrieved by the preliminary decree, don't be under the impression that during final decree proceedings, everything can be set right without preferring a regular appeal. You are taking a great risk. See, one situation I said, death subsequent to the preliminary decree, that can be taken note of. There is something else about which I will tell you, or whatever subsequent developments can be taken note of by the court dealing with final decree proceedings, I will tell. But please be very careful. If a finding given on a particular issue in a preliminary decree, you can't re-agitate it during final decree proceedings. If your client is aggrieved, he has to prefer a regular appeal under Section 96 CPC. Now, what is that further development which can be taken note of by the court dealing with final decree proceedings? At the cost of repetition, I am telling, death subsequent to death of a party or party subsequent to preliminary decree is certainly a circumstance which the court can take note of and accordingly modify the preliminary decree. What other thing? A change in the law can be taken note of by the court dealing with final decree proceedings. I have given some indication about it on the last occasion when I was dealing with the trial of partition suits. The time was not too ripe then to go into details then. But now, of course, since we are exclusively dealing with this, it is necessary to go into details of this. If there is a change in the law subsequent to the passing of a final decree, of course, prior to the passing of a final decree, subsequent to the passing of a preliminary decree, prior to the passing of a final decree, if there is a change in law, whether the court can take note of it. Perhaps you remember, I had referred to this famous decision of the Supreme Court in Sai Reddy versus Narayana Reddy, reported in 1991, volume 3, SEC 647. Please make a note of it. It's a very important decision. 1991, volume 3, SEC 647. Some facts are necessary here. The parties to the suit are from Andhra Pradesh, and a suit was initiated for partition in a court in then Andhra Pradesh. Probably that particular place is now in Telangana, Mehboob Nagar. A suit was filed for partition and all that. Andhra Pradesh state legislature brought an amendment to the Hindu Succession Act. Section 29 capital A was inserted in the Hindu Succession Act. The gist of this amendment is, a daughter was treated as a co-partner. I am referring to the Andhra amendment, not the central amendment of 2005. I am referring to the Andhra amendment. It said the daughter is also a co-partner. Andhra Pradesh made that amendment long back. Now, the matter ultimately reached the Supreme Court. The appeal was against the preliminary decree. Preliminary decree had been passed. Final decree proceedings had not yet been initiated. Final decree had not yet been passed. On some grounds, appeal was preferred. Ultimately, the matter reached the Supreme Court. There it was urged that the daughter, now having been treated as a co-partner by virtue of the amendment brought to the Hindu Succession Act by the Andhra Pradesh State Legislature, she is entitled to a larger share. The other side contended, no, a preliminary decree has already been passed. There is no question of giving a larger share, recognizing her as a co-partner. And it was also said, when once a suit for partition is filed, there is a severance in status, and therefore the question of enhancing the share would not arise. The share is already fixed. The Honorable Supreme Court did not accept that contention to the contrary, and it said, when is a partition said to have taken place under the Hindu law? When a physical division by meets and bounds takes place, or when there is a final decree passed by the court. So long as no final decree is passed, it cannot be said that there is a partition by meets and bounds, and therefore the court can take note of the subsequent change in the law and accordingly enhance the share to that female. This is a very important decision. Why I say important is, this has been followed subsequently by the Supreme Court in other judgments. The next judgment which we can read in this regard is equally famous. This is Gunduri Koteshwaramma versus Chekiri Yanadi, 2011, volume 9, SCC 788. 2011, volume 9, SCC 788. Well, by then, Section 6 was amended by the Parliament. This decision is in the context of amendment brought to Section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act by the Parliament. Referring to this Sai Reddy's case, the Honorable Supreme Court in this Gunduri Koteshwaramma's case held, we have already taken this view. Therefore, even in respect of the central amendment, the same principle would apply. The court can take note of the subsequent change in the law because no final decree is passed and accordingly modified the share. The court also referred to that Poolchand's case, which I have already said, saying that there can be two preliminary decrees. This also you may read. Then we have a judgment in 2011, volume 6 SCC. 2011, volume 6 SCC 642, Prema versus Nanjegowda, a matter from Karnataka. 2011, volume 6 SCC 642, that Sai Reddy's case and this Gunduri have been followed in this case, and it has again been held that the change in the law can be taken note of. If law governing the parties is amended before the conclusion of the final decree proceedings, the party benefited by such amendment can make a request to the court to take cognizance of the amendment and give effect to the same. If the rights of the party to the suit change due to other reasons, the court sees to the final decree proceedings, he is not only entitled, but is duty bound to take note of such change and pass appropriate orders. Then we have the latest judgment in Vinita Sharma, reported in AR 2020 Supreme Court, page 3117. AR 2020 Supreme Court, 3117. I have already drawn your attention to this judgment on the last occasion. It bears repetition in a different context. Vinita Sharma versus Rakesh Sharma. AR 2020 Supreme Court 3117. This is how it reads. Notwithstanding that a preliminary decree has been passed, I read it. Notwithstanding that a preliminary decree has been passed, the daughters are to be given share in the copartnery equal to that of a suit, equal to that of a son, in pending proceedings for final decree or in an appeal. What does that mean? If a matter is pending in appeal, or if a final decree is not yet passed and it is final decree proceedings are pending, well, this change in the law can be taken note of and accordingly an enhanced share can be given, is the view taken by the Supreme Court. Please remember these decisions and make use of them when an occasion arises. Now, if you go through Mullah's Hindu law, you'll know who are all the persons to be implicated in a suit for partition. I have spoken at some length on the last occasion. And I have also told you who are all the persons competent to alienate a joint family property. the manager of a joint family can alienate the properties, the entire body of joint family for legal necessity and benefit of estate. Father has got some special powers of alienation. No other co-partner has that power of alienation. If he alienates, it would only bind his share and not others. Now, an interesting question came before the Supreme Court. Well, if a transfer or alienation takes place before the filing of a suit for partition, there is absolutely no difficulty. Alienee would be necessarily implicated. And the court will examine whether the alienation was for legal necessity, was it by the manager, or was it of a separate property. All those things would definitely the court would examine. But if it is an alienation, if it is an alienation during the pendency of a suit, transferee pendente right, can he be implicated in a final decree proceeding? Is also a question which has been examined by the Supreme Court in the decision reported in 1983, Volume 1, SEC, page 18. 1983, Volume 1, SEC, page 18. I will give the names of the parties also because it's a very important decision which you need to read and go through. It's about 40 or 50 decisions kept in different files. It is taking some time of mine to search them. Please excuse me. It's very much available. Just 2 minutes, I will. Being a very important decision, I want to read a few passages from the decision. Therefore,
Mr. Chandrasekhar has written Khemchand versus Vishnu Hari Patil.
Yes, yes, party's name is correct. The party's name are correct, but I want to read the relevant passage. It is very much available with me. I read it today morning itself. But yes, it is Khemchand Shankar versus Vishnu Hari Patil. It is in 1983, 1 SCC 18. A judgment by Honorable Justice E.S. Venkatramaya, first over CJI. The short question involved in these appeals by special levies, whether the transferees during the pendency of a suit for partition of parts of an estate assessed to payment of land revenue to the government, which is the subject matter of the suit, have locus standing to appear before the revenue authorities in proceedings under Section 54 CPC and ask for an equitable portion of the lands, even though they had not been implicated as parties to the suit in the civil court. Of course, the matter arose in the context of a proceeding under Section 54 before the land revenue authorities, but the principle is important for us. A transferee pendente right could be implicated or need not be implicated. If a transfer takes place before the suit is filed, certainly an alienee or transferee is a necessary party. But if during the pendency of the suit he is not implicated, nothing would happen because Section 52 of the TP Act would be there. He will be bound by the decree. here itself, I may have to draw your attention to Order 22, Rule 10 CPC also. It is necessary to know it to understand the ratio laid down in this decision. Please go to Order 22, Rule 10 CPC. 22 says death, marriage, and insolvency of parties. Judicial officers who have heard me on Order 22 will kindly excuse me for repeating the same word joke. The title is a little not all that happy. Death, marriage, and insolvency. I jokingly tell the title should have been marriage, insolvency, and death. All right, it is death, marriage, and insolvency. Please go to Order 22, Rule 10. Procedure in the case of assignment before final order in suit. In other cases of an assignment, creation, or devolution of any interest during the pendency of a suit, the suit may by leave of the court be continued by or against the person to or upon whom such interest has come or divided. It is an enabling provision. Therefore, if an alienation takes place, not necessarily in a partition suit, in any suit, first, it should be a declaratory suit, not in these permanent injunction suits. In such a case, if an alienation takes place during the pendency of the suit, the plaintiff can implead the alienee or the alienee himself can come on record and continue the suit. Now, His Lordship Justice E.S. Venkatramaiah and this Kemchand's decision has referred to Section 52 of the TP Act, and it is necessary for me to read the observations made. Section 52 of the Transfer of Property Act no doubt lays down that a transferee pendent a right of an interest in an immovable property which is the subject matter of a suit from any of the parties to the suit will be bound in so far as that interest is concerned by the proceedings in the suit. Such a transferee is a representative with interest to the party from whom he has acquired that interest. Rule 10 of Order 22 of the Code of Civil Procedure clearly recognizes the right of a transferee to be implicated as a party to the proceedings and to be heard before any order is made. It's a fairly long passage. Please bear with me. It's very important, and therefore I am spending a good lot of time on reading this. It may be that if he does not apply to be implicated, he may suffer by default on account of any order passed in the proceedings. But if he applies to be implicated as a party and to be heard, he has got to be so implicated in her. He can also prefer an appeal against an order made in the said proceedings, but with the leave of the appellate court when he is not already brought on record. The position of a person, this is important. The position of a person on whom any interest has devolved on account of a transfer during the pendency of any suit or a proceeding is somewhat similar to the position of an heir or a legatee of a party who dies during the pendency of a suit or a proceeding or an official receiver who takes over the assets of such a party in his insolvency. An heir or a legatee or an official receiver or a transferee can participate in the execution proceedings even though their names may not have been shown in the decree, preliminary or final. If they apply to the court to be implicated as parties, they cannot be turned out. The collector who has to effect a partition of an estate under Section 54 has no doubt to divide it in accordance with the decree sent to him. But if a party to such a decree dies, leaving some heirs about whose interest there is no dispute, should he hold up his hands and return the papers to the civil court? So the same thing applies to the civil court dealing with a final decree proceeding. Death is reported during the pendency of the final decree proceedings. Well, if there is no dispute about the death, if there is no dispute about the legal representatives, why should the court say, no, you file another suit? He need not do so. He may proceed to allot the share of the deceased party to his heirs. Similarly, he may, when there is no dispute, allot the share of a deceased party in favor of his legatees. In the case of insolvency of a party, the official receiver may be allotted the share of the insolvent. In the case of transferees pendent a right also, if there is no dispute, the collector may proceed to make allotment of properties in an equitable manner instead of rejecting their claim for such equitable partition on the ground that they have no locus standi. Obviously, a transferee would come with a registered title deed. Well, that may be sufficient proof, or even if there is dispute, a formal inquiry to satisfy the court's conscience that there is a transfer is sufficient. A transferee from a party of a property which is the subject matter of partition can exercise all the rights of the transferor. There is no dispute that a party can ask for an equitable partition. A transferee from him, therefore, can also do this. Such a construction of Section 54 advances the cause of justice. Otherwise, in every case where a party dies, or a party is adjudicated as an insolvent, or when he transfers some interest in the suit property pendent taillight, the matter has got to be referred back to the civil court. Of course, in other cases, the matter is in the civil court itself. Even though there may be no dispute about succession, devolution, or transfer of interest. In any such case where there is no dispute, if the collector makes an equitable partition, taking into consideration the interest of all concerned, including those on whom any interest in the subject matter has devolved, he would neither be violating the decree nor transgressing any law. His action would not be ultra vires. On the other hand, it would be in conformity with the intention of the legislature, which has placed the work of partition of land subject to payment of assessment to the government in his hands to be carried out in accordance with law. So, if the Honorable Supreme Court says that the collector also can implead the transferee and suitably modify the share and all that, perforce it follows that a civil court which is seized of the final decree proceedings can certainly do it. In fact, the civil court would be better placed to examine whether there is a valid transfer, whether it is by way of a registered instrument, whether the transfer is proved in accordance with the title deed is proved in accordance with the law, all that could be done. Of course, I read out this very judgment and it says that a legatee also can come on record during the final decree proceedings. Here, some explanation is required. In what situations the claim of a legatee or the claim of a person claiming to be a legatee can be examined? Of course, I am not backed by any decision except that decision where it says a legatee cannot. I have conceded of some situations. The first situation is this. If the will is prior to the suit and the legatee is an heir of the propositus, please follow this. H is the propositus. A suit is filed for partition. That legatee is an heir of the propositus and he is a party to the suit. H is the propositus. A suit is filed by A against B, C, D, and E. Let us say C is a legatee under a will executed by X. If he doesn't raise the question of will during the pendency of the suit, I don't think that he can be allowed to raise a plea on the basis of the will during FTP. It is only after the death of the propositus X the suit is filed. This legatee claiming under that propositus, saying that the propositus has executed a will, does not raise the question of will when the suit is pending or before the preliminary decree can be passed, I don't think that he can be allowed to raise a plea on the basis of will during FTP because that plea was very much available to him when the court passed the preliminary decree. Supposing if the will is executed during the pendency of the suit and by a party to the suit, either the plaintiff or the defendant executes a will during the pendency of a suit, and that party dies. Plaintiff executes a will in favor of some X or in favor of one of the other parties to the suit, or the defendant executes and he dies. But the legatee does not choose to come on record in the suit. Whatever share the deceased testator party, that is the plaintiff or the defendant, is given in the preliminary decree, will go to the legatee, and the legatee may have to be permitted to prove the will in FTP. This is my thinking. You can't ask me to cite a decision. Well, you can examine. You are also free to take your own view. I think there should not be any bar. Then, if a person claiming to be a legatee under a person who is not a party to the suit in which the preliminary decree is passed wants to come on record during FTP, he cannot be permitted. Well, some person is not a party to the suit at all. He claims to be a legatee. He can't say that during final decree proceedings, my right under the will needs to be examined. So this is another aspect of the matter which you will bear in mind. So now, what is it that we have seen? We have seen that there can be a preliminary decree and a final decree. It could be partly preliminary, it could be partly final. There can be a number of preliminary decrees. there can also be a second final decree. I mean, there can be two final decrees. And then we have said that the court dealing with final decree proceedings cannot go behind the preliminary decree. If an appeal is not preferred against the preliminary decree, in the appeal that is preferred against the final decree, that finding cannot be urged in view of Section 97 CPC. No need to file a petition for initiation of final decree proceedings. It is the court's duty to do it. Even if such a petition is filed, the court has to take it as a reminder to it to perform its duty. There is no period of limitation provided for this. Transferee pendent a light can be brought on record. Change in the law can be taken note of. And a preliminary decree can be varied. A preliminary decree can be modified. And shares can be varied. Now, a final decree needs to be engrossed on a stamp paper. I am able to give the specific provision as far as Karnataka is concerned. Elsewhere, there may be such a provision. I will give the judgment of the Supreme Court also a little later. First, let us go to Section 2K of the Karnataka Stamp Act. I am reading Section 2K of the Karnataka Stamp Act. Instrument of partition means any instrument whereby the co-owners of any property divide or agree to divide such property in severalty and includes a final order for effecting a partition passed by any revenue authority, obviously under Section 54 CPC or AD Civil Court. Therefore, a final decree passed by a civil court is also treated as an instrument of partition under the Karnataka Stamp Act, and stamp duty has to be paid. Probably it is under article, whichever is the article, let's not worry about it. It provides for levying stamp duty. Now, a final decree has to be engrossed on a stamp paper. Please go to 1995 3 SCC 1995 volume 3 SCC 413. This is a decision of the Supreme Court. Obviously, it applies to the whole of the country. Of course, supposing if any state stamp act itself says that no stamp duty, specifically it says that no stamp duty is payable on a final decree, certainly this decision the Supreme Court will not come in the way. But if there is no provision and stamp duty has to be paid, then the final decree will have to be engrossed on a stamp paper. 1995 3 SCC 413. There's not much to be read from the judgment. Since I have a number of decisions, it is taking time for me to search. Yes, 1995 3 SCC 413. Shankar Balavan Lakhande. Shankar Balavan Lakhande versus Chandrakant Shankar. I am reading para 12 at page 419. As to Matsudan's case, we state that it has not been correctly decided. Limitation does not begin to run out from the date when the direction is given to pass a final decree. Mere giving up a direction to supply stamped paper for passing a final decree does not amount to passing a final decree. Until the final decree determining the rights of the parties by meets and bounds is drawn up and engrossed on a stamp paper supplied by the parties, there is no executable decree. Of course, reference is made to the Bombay Stamp Act. And then, therefore, the executing court cannot receive the preliminary decree unless the final decree is passed as Administrative Order 20, Rule 18, Subrule 2. After the final decree is passed and a direction is issued to pay stamped papers for engrossing final decree thereon, and the same is duly engrossed on stamped papers, it becomes executable or becomes an instrument duly stamped. Thus, the condition precedent is to draw up a final decree and then to engross it on stamped papers of required value. These two acts together constitute a final decree, crystallizing the rights of the parties in terms of the preliminary decree. Till then, there is no executable decree as enunciated in Order 20, Rule 80. This decision of the Supreme Court has been followed by the Karnataka High Court in a decision reported in AER 2002 Karnataka 439. AER 2002 Karnataka 439, AP Mandanna versus AP Kushalappa. Now, there are two things here. Normally, in partition suits, with the passing of a final decree, the proceedings come to an end. Hardly there may be any occasion for the parties to initiate an execution proceeding, because the commissioner would have gone there, he would have divided the properties, he would have shown which portion should go to the first plaintiff, which portion should go to the second plaintiff, defendant and all that. He submits a report, he gives a sketch. The parties would either file their objections or the court would say, well, it's fine, and accordingly allot it. Many times the parties would have already taken possession also in terms of the report given by the commissioner, and hardly an occasion arises to execute a final decree for partition. I may tell you, having worked in the Karnataka judiciary as a trial judge for 31 and a half years, I had no occasion to deal with an execution petition in respect of a partition suit. Maybe final decree proceedings, but not execution proceedings at all. Obviously, such a situation would not arise. Assuming the situation is like this, this is how it happens. ABCD are members or co-sharers. In terms of the report of the commissioner, a portion, rather a land or a portion of the land has to go to A. That is how he has proposed it. The court also accepts the report, and for some reason, let us say, either the house of A is near that land, and therefore it is felt if this land is given to A's share, well, it would be convenient for him to have access to the house. Or maybe A has his own separate land somewhere there, and if a share in this land is given to him, it would be convenient. There is no dispute about it. But actual physical possession or occupation is with the defendant. Despite this final decree, he doesn't deliver possession of that. Then an occasion might arise for this plaintiff A to file an execution petition, seeking direction to the defendant to deliver possession of the property allotted to him in terms of the final decree. There the question of execution of the final decree comes. Normally it doesn't come. I am not telling that final decree proceedings and execution are one and the same. Please don't mistake me that way. I am not telling it at all. An occasion to execute a final decree in a partition suit hardly arises. So one such situation I gave is where physical possession is with one of the defendants and that property is allotted to the plaintiff, or vice versa also, then there may be an occasion to execute the final decree. Here again, when it comes to execution, we are bound by the provisions of the Limitation Act. Limitation Act provides a particular period for filing an execution petition. Don't impute your knowledge of this final decree proceedings saying that there is no period of limitation for initiation of final decree proceedings in partition suits. If it is a question of executing a decree, final decree for partition, certainly the provisions of the Limitation Act in the matter of execution would be applicable. That has been clarified both in this decision of the Supreme Court and by our High Court in the decision cited by me. So then, the stamp duty I have told you. The next question is whether a final decree requires registration. Well, this is something which is troubling. As I told you on the last occasion, Before I started my presentation, I had heard Chitra Sampath, her presentation on YouTube. She also said that a final degree does not require registration. If you have with you the registration act, please go to section 17. 17.1 gives a list of 5 documents which require compulsory registration. 17.1 A to E. It gives a list of documents for which registration is compulsory or mandatory. 17.1 A, I have exhausted myself about it only for the purpose of section 53 A. 17.2, it's an exception. Nothing in classes B and C of subsection applies to. Here, 13 documents are referred to, which does not require registration. 17.2 gives a list of documents which does not require registration. Nothing in clauses B and C of subsection 1 applies to. What does that mean? In respect of the documents shown in clauses 1 to 12, of course, there is an addition 10A, therefore, totally it would be 13. But in respect of these 13 documents, no registration is required. Please hear me very carefully. 17.1 gives a list of 5 documents which require compulsory registration. 17.1A is an independent subsection. It deals with a document for purposes of section 53A of the TP Act. 17.2 gives a list of 13 documents which does not require registration. One of those is this. It is 17.2.6, Roman 6, 17.2.6. Any decree or order of a court, please read it very carefully if you have the book with you. If you do not have the book with you, please hear me very carefully. Any decree or order of a court, within brackets, except a decree or order expressed to be made on a compromise and comprising immovable property other than that which is the subject matter of the suit or proceeding. What does that mean? A decree or an order of a court does not require registration. Day in and day out, you would be passing several decrees. It does not require registration. When does a decree require registration? Except a decree or order expressed to be made on a compromise and comprising immovable property other than that which is the subject matter of the suit or proceeding. All compromise, no decree requires registration. All compromise decrees also do not require registration. If the compromise decree is in respect of an immovable property, which is not the subject matter of the suit, then only such a compromise decree requires registration. Please go to Order 23, Rule 3, CPC. 23, Rule 3. Compromise of suit. Where it is proved to the satisfaction of the court that a suit has been adjusted wholly or in part by any lawful agreement or compromise in writing and signed by the parties, or where the defendant satisfies the plaintiff in respect of the whole or any part of the subject matter of the suit, the court shall order such agreement, compromise, or satisfaction to be recorded and shall pass a decree in accordance therewith, so far as it relates to the parties to the suit, whether or not the subject matter of the agreement, compromise, or satisfaction is the same as the subject matter of the suit. When the Civil Procedure Code came to be amended by Act No. 104 of 1976 with effect from 1-2-1977, our Rule 3 of Order 23 also came to be amended, and since then, there can be a compromise in respect of a property which is not the subject matter of the suit. Therefore, if under a compromise decree, a party gets a right in respect of a property which is not the subject matter of the suit, it is only that property is included in the compromise decree, then such a compromise decree requires registration. Therefore, no other compromise decree requires registration. No other decree passed on contest requires registration. There is no question of a final decree being registered. Merely because final decree requires to be drawn on a stamp paper, it does not follow that it requires registration. Please understand. A document being written on a stamp paper is one thing. A document requires registration, it is two different things. Now, as per the plain language of Order 17, Rule 2, Clause 6, a compromise decree in respect of a property which is not the subject matter of the suit requires registration. Then which other compromise decree requires registration? There is a judicial interpretation for it. First, make a note of these decisions. 1995, Volume 5, SCC 709. 1995, Volume 5, SCC 709. 1996, Volume 3, SCC 289. 1996, Volume 3, SCC 289. 2006, Volume 10, SCC 788. 2006, Volume 10, SCC 788. 2008, Volume 13, SCC 102. 2008, Volume 13, SCC 102. Then 2015, Volume 3, SCC 465. I repeat, 1995, Volume 3, SCC 709. 1996, Volume 3, SCC 289. 2006, Volume 10, SCC 788. 2008, Volume 13, SCC 102. 2015, Volume 3, SCC 465. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Though I have given these 5 decisions, you better read three of them compulsorily. 1995, 5 SCC 709. Then 2006, 10 SCC 788. 2015, 3 SCC 465. That is the latest decision. You please, because 2015, 3 SCC 465 is by a larger bench, because there are some conflict of view. Now, what has been held in these decisions is, if for the first time a party gets a right in respect of an immobile property worth more than rupees 100 under a decree, then it requires registration. Under a compromise decree, if a party for the first time gets a right, he did not have a pre-existing right, then it requires registration. This requires an example to understand. Forget about a partition suit. Take a suit for declaration of title. A suit for declaration of title is filed in respect of a particular property. Let us say it measures 4 acres of land. Plaintiff files a suit for declaration of title in respect of 4 acres of land. Plaintiff and the defendant enter into a compromise. The compromise is this. Out of these 4 acres, plaintiff should give 2 acres to the defendant. In turn, the defendant would give some 2 acres or 1 acre or some property belonging to him to the plaintiff. This is the terms of the compromise. Certainly, that compromise is permissible in view of Order 23, Rule 3. There can be a compromise in respect of a property which is not the subject matter of the suit. The subject matter of the suit for declaration of title is 4 acres of land. Now the compromise is, plaintiff would give up 2 acres to the defendant. In turn, the defendant would give some property to the plaintiff. The property which the defendant would give to the plaintiff is not the subject matter of the suit. Plaintiff gets right to that property, which is not the subject matter of the suit, in terms of this decree. Therefore, it requires registration under 17.2.6. Now, in respect of these 2 acres of land, out of these 4 acres, defendant for the first time under this decree gets a right. He did not have a pre-existing right in respect of these 2 acres of land. Under the decree, for the first time, he gets that right. Therefore, it requires registration. This is what has been held in this 1995 SEC 709. So, number one, as per the provisions of 1726, if a decree, if a compromise decree is in respect of a property which is not the subject matter of the suit, it requires registration, because plain reading of the provision makes it clear. As per these decisions, if there is no pre-existing right, if under the compromise decree the parties for the first time get a right, then it requires registration. Now, in the context of a partition suit, it might happen like this. Plaintiff files a suit in respect of joint family properties. Defendants contend that there are certain other properties which also belong to the family. The plaintiff deliberately has not included them. Plaintiff would contend they are his self-acquisitions and therefore he has not included them. Now, a compromise is entered into. It is conceded by the defendants that they are self-acquisitions of the plaintiffs. Or even if there is no such conceding, or even if there is no such contest, when they enter into a compromise, the self-acquisitions of the plaintiff, the self-acquisitions of the defendant are also brought. Then, for the first time, the plaintiff gets a right in respect of the self-acquisitions of the defendant. For the first time, the defendant gets a right or a share in the self-acquisitions of the plaintiff. So, when there was no pre-existing right, and when for the first occasion the parties get a share or a right in respect of a property under a compromise, then it requires registration. This is another thing which you will bear in mind. Now, whenever we deal with these final decree proceedings in partition suits, a reference to the Partition Act is also required. Before I part with you for the day, let me cursorily take you through the provisions of the Partition Act. It's a very brief, it's a very short enactment containing only 10 sections. I am not taking you through all these provisions for want of time. I am only giving you the object of this enactment and how it can be made use of. We have an indication from Order 20, Rule 18, Subrule 1, Subrule 2, which I read at least twice. Today, twice or thrice, on the last occasion, at least once. I said, if without further inquiry, the court cannot say whether the partition by meets and bounds is permissible, a preliminary decree would be passed. Now, final decree proceedings are initiated. It turns out that the immovable property, which is the subject matter of that decree, preliminary decree, cannot be divided by meets and bounds. Then, the provisions of the Partition Act are taken recourse to. It provides for a sale of that property, and one would get the property, the others would get money. This is, in brief, the scheme of the Partition Act. I don't have time to deal with it in great detail, but I would, for the benefit of the audience, refer to some important decisions of the Supreme Court and be done away with it, part with you after referring to those decisions. One important decision of the Supreme Court, which is frequently referred to by the Supreme Court in other decisions and other high courts, is in that Ramamurthy Iyer versus Raja V. Rajeshwar Rao's case, or Ramamurthy Iyer versus Raja V. Rajeshwar Rao, AER 1973 Supreme Court 643. AER 1973 Supreme Court 643. It's also reported in 1972, Volume 2, SEC 721. I will first give the citations. Thereafter, only I refer to this Ramamurthy Iyer and be done away with it. The next is AER 1978 Supreme Court 845. AER 1978 Supreme Court 845. AER 1991 Supreme Court 700. AER 1991 Supreme Court 700, AER 1997 Supreme Court 471, AER 1997 Supreme Court 471, AER 2000 Supreme Court 2684, AER 2000 Supreme Court 2684, AER 2001 Supreme Court 61, AER 2001 Supreme Court 61, AER 2002 Supreme Court 2434, AER 2002 Supreme Court 2434, AER 2002 Supreme Court 2500, AER 2002 Supreme Court 2500, then 2009 Volume 13 SEC 569. These are some important decisions of the Supreme Court dealing with the Partition Act. You see, Section 2 reads like this. It appears to the court that by reason of the nature of the property to which the suit relates, or the number of the shareholders therein, or of any other special circumstance, a division of the property cannot reasonably or conveniently be made, and that a sale of the property and distribution of the proceeds would be more beneficial for all the shareholders, the court may, if it thinks fit, on the request of any of such shareholders interested individually or collectively to the extent of one moiety or upwards, direct a sale of the property and distribution. In this Ramamurthy Iyer's case, the Supreme Court has said, the court need not give a definite finding that the property is incapable of division by meets and bounds. Even if it appears to the court, it is sufficient. Now let us take a big house. It's quite common in villages. There is a big house. There is a very big hall, but a small bedroom, one common bathroom. No doubt the house is quite big. Is it capable of division by meets and bounds? Is it necessary to appoint an engineer and give a report saying that it is incapable of division by meets and bounds? A mere look at that house, a photograph would satisfy the court that if it appears to the court that a physical division is impossible, then the provisions of the Partition Act can be taken recourse to, is what this Ramamurthy Iyer's case held. Well, procedure is there. The provisions of the Civil Procedure Code relating to sale in execution proceedings would apply to these things also. Well, there can be a sale between the parties to the suit. If it is not possible, then there could be a public auction also. This is, with this, I believe I have drawn the final decree also. So I drew the preliminary decree last week. I have drawn the final decree also. So if you have got any questions, I will be pleased to answer.
Yes, sir. This is by Chandrasekhar. Suit is filed in the year 2008.
Yes.
But one of the properties incorporated in 2010.
Yes.
Which is purchased in the year 2009. Whether purchase is necessary in FDP?
The question is this. Suit is filed in the year 2008. The particular property which was purchased in the year 2010 was not the subject matter of the suit. And I don't think in a partition suit in respect of some property belonging to someone else, the court need to bother itself during final decree proceedings. See, what I said is this. In the context of registration, I said if it is a compromise decree, if some other property is included, it requires registration and all that. But that is not the situation here. Suit is filed in the year 2008 or 2009. Some property is purchased. Is it the subject matter of the suit or some other property? Mr. Chandrasekhar? Is it the subject matter of the suit that is purchased or some other property?
So you will share it on the WhatsApp. Meanwhile, this is in the final decree proceedings. If one of the scheduled properties to be is of the scheduled property is sold to the third party, a building is constructed thereon. Can a third party be implicated in this?
Yes, he can be implicated. He can certainly be implicated. There should be no difficulty.
Chandrasekhar says incorporated by amendment.
Incorporated by?
amendment.
Yes, you can bring it, you can examine that. Of course, if it doesn't require so much of inquiry, if on the basis of the pleadings and other things, such an inquiry could be made, certainly it could be pleaded. There should be no difficulty. Then,
this is on the YouTube.
Chandrasekhar's question, suit is filed in the year 2008.
So this is what I read to you.
But one of the properties incorporated in 2010, which is purchased. So the question is this, there is already a preliminary decree. When you say final decree proceedings, there is already a preliminary decree. In the preliminary decree, rather in the suit, which culminated in the preliminary decree, this property was not included. That cannot be included during final decree proceedings, and we can't examine whether it is a joint family property or it is a separate property and all. From what source he purchased the property, all this requires some adjudication. I don't think that this could be included in a final decree proceeding.
What is the scope of compromise in the final decree proceedings?
The same thing, Order 23, Rule 3, the compromise should be lawful, the compromise should be voluntary, definitely. And as I said, if some other property is included, or if for the first time a party gets a right, it requires registration.
Decree holder purchases the property of a defendant in money decree with the leave of the court. No. Does that sale certificate require registration?
No. Sale certificate does not require registration. It is made clear in the Registration Act itself. A sale certificate issued by a civil court under Order 21, Rule 94, CPC does not require registration. Of course, it is outside the scope of today's presentation, but anyway, coming as it does from a junior member of the bar, I believe, I don't mind answering that question. Please go to Order Section 17, Subsection 2. Subsection 2. Clause 12, any certificate of sale granted to the purchaser of any property sold by public auction by a civil or revenue officer, it does not require registration. And in fact, here again, we have a judgment of Justice R.V. Ravindran of the Supreme Court saying that a sale certificate issued under Order 21, Rule 94, CPC does not require registration. But an intimation is sent under the Karnataka Civil Rules of Practice. An intimation will be sent to the sub-registrar. A copy of the sale certificate will have to be furnished. Obviously, when a copy is sent, there is no question of registration. Intimation will go to the sub-registrar. No registration is required.
Santosh Goda. So this question is long. A had purchased the property before the institution of the partition suit, but the sale deed was kept pending under Section 45A of the Stamp Act. The sellers got the partition suit without implicating the purchaser. Now A has got the sale.
The seller got the partition suit filed without implicating the purchaser. Now A has got the sale deed registration completed. Can A himself get implicated in the final decree proceedings? No. You see, in the preliminary decree, this property was not included. I don't think that he can do it. No.
Yeah. So meanwhile, I will request Mr. Santosh Goda. Somehow he has become the host. He should transfer the host rights to me.
Twice.
Here it's over. I will ask, take from the YouTube. If any person had died without a will and he was unmarried and his brother and sister also died, he has two mothers, then how can his property will be distributed amongst the nephews? Will be distributed amongst his nephews? This is the question.
Help me. It takes us to the provisions of the Hindu Succession Act. We have class 1 years, class 2 years. So it requires an analysis how these parties are related to the testate, to the person who died intestate. You see, Section 8 of the Hindu Succession Act.
Yes, sir.
So, what's the situation I gave
you? Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes. You see, Section 8, firstly, upon the years being the relative specified in Class 1, secondly, if there is no year, then upon the years being the relative specified in Class 2. Well, it requires factual examination. How the persons claiming a share are related to the intestate, whether they are Class 1 years or Class 2 years, are there Class 1 years, If there are no class 1 years, then class 2 years. In class 2 years also, there are different entries. Each entry would exclude the other one. Persons mentioned in one entry would exclude the other one. It requires factual examination. You will have to have a genealogy, find out how the plaintiff who is claiming a share is related to the interstate. Of course, it also depends upon the fact whether the property is joint family property or ancestral property or the separate property of the interstate.
Mm-hmm. When a party paid for a share, can the court grant monetary compensation by way of preliminary decree?
No, in the question of granting monetary compensation, a preliminary decree does not arise. It is only during final decree proceedings if the court comes to a conclusion that the property cannot be divided by meets and bounds. Well, taking recourse to the provisions of the Partition Act, the property is sold and one person is compensated. There is also a concept of ovalty that has also been explained by the Supreme Court in one of the decisions. Supposing one property is given, 2 acres of land is given to the plaintiff. It's a wetland, very yielding. Another property is given, 1 acre, dry land is given. Well, to apportion that, to see that the same thing is balanced, well, some other property equal to that can also be given. This is called the concept of ovalty. In one of the decisions which I have referred to, that concept of ovalty has also been explained by the Supreme Court. It's also necessary to be kept in view by the advocates who conduct partition cases. There is one other question. If a sale deed is cancelled in cancellation declaration suit, does the decree of cancellation require registration and whether stamp duty has to be paid even though the court fee is to be paid? There are two different aspects. Now, to institute a suit for cancellation of a decree, court fee is payable. Of course, I'm sure that even in other states, some court fee is levied. In Karnataka, the relevant provision is Section 38. Please have a look at Section 31 of the Specific Relief Act. If a sale deed is cancelled, first minute, in cancellation, does the decree of cancellation require registration? No. Please go to Section 31 of the Specific Relief Act. Any person against whom a written instrument is void or voidable and who has reasonable apprehension that such instrument, if left outstanding, may cause him serious injury, may sue to have it adjudged void or voidable, and the court may in its discretion so adjudge it and order it to be delivered up and cancelled. Therefore, that instrument should be either void or voidable in terms of the provisions of Section 19 of the Specific Contract Act. And then subsection 2. If the instrument has been registered under the Indian Registration Act, the court shall send a copy of its decree to the officer in whose instrument the has been registered, and such officer shall note on the copy of the instrument contained in his books the fact of its cancellation. The registrar is only required to make a note that the instrument has been cancelled. It is not a question of registration of a cancellation decree. The court has to send a copy of its decree. It does not require registration.
Is Partition Act applicable in all states?
That I will have to examine. At least as far as my state is concerned, it is applicable. Sir, some question regarding appeal. If the appeal is pending and the purchaser comes to know about the pendency of the suit, then the purchaser has to file an application for impleading in the original suit or in FTP. See, this happens. If the appeal is pending, sometimes, now this requires some, let me also tell. If an appeal is preferred against a preliminary decree, the legal position is the appellate court cannot stay the final decree proceedings. It can only stay the passing of the final decree, because the Supreme Court has said Since final decree proceedings take a long time for its culmination, it is not proper for the appellate court to stay the proceedings of the final decree. Only the drawing up of the final decree has to be stayed. Now the question is this. If an appeal is pending and the purchaser comes to know about the pendency of the suit, then the purchaser has to file an application for repleading in the original suit or in the FDP. Appeal is pending, the question of making an application in the original suit would not arise. Now when the appeal is pending, if we can make out a case as to why you did not choose to implead yourself in the suit, he may plead that he was not aware of the pendency of the suit. Well, he can come up on record in the appellate court. In fact, the judgment of Justice E.S. Venkatramaya, which I read out, he will also give an indication that some other person affected by the decree, who is not a party to the suit or who is not a party to the decree, can also prefer an appeal. There is that indication, and there are other judgments also say that a person who is not a party to the suit can also prefer a regular appeal if he is aggrieved by the decree. He has to seek the leave of the court. Maybe he can come on record in the appeal saying that I am a purchaser.
Even under the law says that the appeal is a much larger scope than the review.
Yes.
For bleeding, etc.
Definitely.
Is agreement to partition can claim by way of specific performance?
I don't think that a suit for specific performance would lie seeking a decree for effecting a partition. Doubtful.
So, what is the procedure for transferring the decree? Not transmission of decree. Is registration required?
No. The transfer of a decree, it is contemplated by the Civil Procedure Code. You see, if the defendant does not reside within the jurisdiction of the court, his arrest is required. Or if he does not, rather the judgment debtor does not have properties within the jurisdiction of the court which passed the decree, then the court can transfer the decree to a place where the judgment debtor has property or where he stays. That is clear from section 38 and 39. There is no question of registration there.
So you will be taking the last question in mortgage suit. If mortgager transfers the property to a mortgagee in a mortgage suit by compromise, does the compromise require a registration?
Again, the point is this. A compromise requires registration if the compromise is in respect of a property which is not the subject matter of the suit, or if in terms of the compromise for the first time the party gets a right.
Yes, sir. So thank you. The questions will keep on pouring. There will be no end to it. And thank you for enlightening us. I'm seeing on the YouTube as well as on the Facebook, they're all too happy that you have shared the knowledge, and that too. Those who have missed the previous webinars, sir has taken 3 sessions on these partitions. You can watch them on the channel of Beyond Law CLC. And sir, we would like to share that Mr. P.K. Devdas has agreed, and tomorrow we will be having a session on post-mortem reports and criminal trials. Do stay connected with us, not you, but all the participants on the in the criminal trial at 4:30 p.m. tomorrow. Thank you, everyone. Stay safe. Stay blessed. Thank you.
Before I conclude,
yes, sir.
I see on the video my good friend Mr. V.N. Ravindra, a retired state judge. We worked together in Mysore for about 2 years. He is my good friend. He is in constant touch with me. He also comes to the Judicial Academy. I see him. He's my very good friend. So,
In Hindi, they say, "Ek se bhale do." We will ask him to share his knowledge. I will ask you to share his number. We will ask him to share his insights.
Of course, with his permission, of course.
If he raises a thumbs up, we will ask his number. Thank you. Though the folded hands also show that he's saying, "Bas karo." Thank you, sir. Thank you. Mr. Gowda, you can close the meeting, since perchance I've told you that you have got the rights of the host in the meeting. Okay, thank you. I have become the host. Thank you, everyone.